I'm going to put you in remembrance, some of y'all, something that you need to stay in remembrance of. You know, the Bible talks about being reminded of things, because how many of we tend to forget? Me and Sheree. Rest of y'all? God bless your sharp minds. Sheree, you got a birthday coming up. I just had one, right? Got an anniversary coming up this Thursday, 28th. Yeah, yeah. Hey, Kit saw it today and went, oh, man, thanks. Salvation comes to this house on many levels. I want to talk to you this morning about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Some of you go, I already have that. Well, good. Then you'll learn more about him today. More about him. How many of you, he's a him. Hallelujah. How many of you, God's Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. In Joel chapter 2, verse 27, Joel stands up and prophesies that that one day God's going to pour out a spirit upon all flesh. Verse 27 says, and then you shall know I'm in the midst of Israel, and I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. My people shall never be ashamed. How many of y'all that know Jesus aren't ashamed? Amen. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. You know, there's a revival breaking out in Iran. I don't know if y'all know that, but yeah, God's pouring out his spirit on Muslim flesh, Baptist flesh, Mormon flesh, Catholic flesh, Hindu flesh. We saw a clip the other day of a Buddhist priest that died. He was dead for 3 days, people. 3 days. Not three minutes. 3 days. They were about to cremate him, and he stood. And they were about to. They were having the last viewing of him. And they were about to nail the coffin and set it on fire. And he sat up. And he said, everything that we've been... He was a Buddhist priest. He said, everything that we've been taught is a lie. The Christians have the truth. He just spent 3 days going to hell, going to heaven, talking to Peter, and he was sent back. There was... he's been all over his neck of the woods telling people the truth. God's doing crazy things in the earth right now, folks. So we're going, I don't know if I believe that. You don't have to. He believes it. All the people that saw him rise from the dead, they first thought he was a ghost. Most of them started running. But you can see it on YouTube. Type in Buddhist priest that was resurrected. It's there. Hallelujah. God's pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. He's pouring it out, not with an eyedropper. We sang about a river at last night. The songs were in tune for what I'm talking about today, and they didn't know. Jesus said, out of the bellies of men shall flow rivers of living water, not drips. Amen. We're a river. I mean, a river can move things. Try to stop a river. Can't do it. Hallelujah. I pour my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Young men, you're supposed to be seeing visions. Your old men are supposed to be dreaming dreams. Your sons and daughters are supposed to be prophesying. When's the last time you prophesied? I ain't never prophesied. Well, you need to get after it. For all of you that are filled with the Holy Ghost and speak with other tongues, you need to take it to another level. To you that aren't, you need to come into it. Amen? I prayed for Jessica 2 weeks ago on a Sunday after church back in the office, and her and Sarah. Boy, they got filled and spoke in tongues. It was awesome. I prayed for a young man that doesn't go to this church, came here a few weeks ago. I took him through deliverance. and he had a major deliverance. He was 37-year-old, and he came back Monday, and I prayed him through the Holy Ghost. When I laid hands on him, I'm telling you, this guy, I haven't seen rockets. I've seen rockets with less. I laid hands on him, and he just began to pray in the Spirit and just glorify God, and it was evident he had received something. Not, boy, I hope I mumble something. He couldn't wait to leave the office because he wanted to get back in his car. He wanted to get after it. I said, you want to leave because you want to get in your car and get after it. I really do. I really don't want to talk right now. I just want to just keep praying in this. And that's a good sign. Amen. Some people pray in the Spirit. They go, I don't know. That was weird. They're so self-conscious. When you get in a river, if it's a really, really big flowing river, how many of you get tumbled and tossed? Matt was surfing the other day, and he didn't ride all of them. Some of them rode him. If you've ever been pummeled by a wave, that's a good baptism, because you're immersed and you're around, you're on the bottom, you're kicking up sand, you're going, whoa, let me go, and you finally come up only to see another one. Amen. We need to have encounters with God that are so, we're almost so out of control. I'm going to say that with grace, because I know there's people that watch this on YouTube. I'm not saying out of control and getting crazy. You know, some people, I came out of Pentecost, and I've seen a lot of stuff out of control that was not God. I've seen people running around the church with their eyes closed and running, slapping to a post. Boom! I was at a church one time and heard this big old boom. I thought, we don't have a bell. Where's that coming? And some guy was running around, ooh, praise you, Jesus, boom, and he ran right into a big old metal pillar that was in the. Well, it was the Lord. He had a big goose egg. Nothing happened because it was God. No, that which is flesh is flesh. When flesh hits steel, steel wins. Well, if he was in the Spirit, see, people that get goofy like that, they bring reproach to Christ. You don't have to be goofy. If you want to run around, open your eyes. If the joy of the Lord's on you and you can't contain yourself, have you ever been so happy you can't contain yourself? Four of you. What is the wrong with this house? You know, Powerball right now is $350 million. What happened? What if you won it?
Well, I would just glorify God. I would think that would be an awesome thing.
Oh, you won't win it. Amen? But wouldn't you be a little excited? Y'all going to pay attention this morning? Come on, look up here. Don't do Bible studies right now. This is the study right now. Let's pay attention. God has great things for us today. I just came back from imparting some really cool things to other people. I want to impart that to you guys. No offense, I love y'all more than most. I'm supposed to. I'm not the shepherd of the Four Corners Church. I'm the shepherd at Church in Ramona. I'm not laying my life down for them. I'm laying my life down for you. God has gifts. If God's going to give you a gift, you think it's going to be a good one? What could God ever give you as a gift that you wouldn't just be totally freaked out about? If he gave you a little piece of pebble off his street, it would be a pretty cool thing, wouldn't it? Because last I checked, he paves his streets with gold. So if God just kicked the curb and broke off a little chunk and it ended up in your house somewhere, it'd probably pay off your house. It might be able to buy your neighborhood. Depends on how big his foot is. But I mean, that's his streets. He that finds a wife finds a good thing. I mean, that's a great gift. All the happy married people are nodding. Some of y'all aren't nodding. It's not good. It's kind of scaring me. Well, I believe it's the gift that keeps on getting better. Well, it does. But he that finds a wife finds a good thing, obtains favor with the Lord. It's a gift from God. How many of y'all, salvation's a gift? Y'all like being saved? If you don't, you can always go back to Egypt. You can always go back there and start, no thank you. All right, so he's going to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh, your sons and daughters, mom and dad, your kids, everybody. I want to tell you something. This is for everybody in the house. How many of your children are saved? Anybody got kids saved? Okay. If your children are saved, they can receive this gift. Yeah, you know what I want to go on in Sunday school? I want what goes on in Sunday school to be what goes on out here, just on their level. So as long as we've had this church for 30 years in Ramona, our kids have known salvation and the baptism of the Holy Spirit in their youth, usually in elementary school. Well, Brother Mike, they can't really know what they can't really get that. Really? It doesn't say how old your sons and daughters have to be. If you can be born again, you can be filled with the Holy Spirit. I would much rather pray for kids to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit than adults, because kids are childlike. Really? Yeah. Just pray for them, they receive. Adults, I don't know. It's really rubbing the grain here. Kids ain't got much grain. You know what I mean? All right. Hey, sponges. All right, it was prophets 750 years before Jesus even showed up. The prophet Joel said, in the last days, God's going to pour out a spirit. Do you realize the last days started 2,000 years ago? So if you ever ask anybody, you think we're in the last days? They go, I don't know. You can say, oh, we are. Well, how do you know? Well, it started on the day of Pentecost. It started 2,000 years ago. That was the beginning of the last days. So what are we in? I think we're in the last seconds of the last days. I think things are happening so rapid and so crazy, we need all the power we can get. And that's one thing the Holy Spirit gives you is power. We sang about I get convicted sometimes singing these songs. I have a river, it's power, it's glory. And we go through the week sometimes depressed. How do we have grace on our life and glory and power and we battle depression? These things ought not to be. I was talking to somebody the other day and they said, I've just been so stressed out. I don't know what stress is. He doesn't. I do, because he doesn't have a clue what's going on half the time. Hey, delegate, man. That's what I say. delegate, dance to the music. You know the song. All right. But you know, God, you know, even though Brenda has the books at the house and stuff, and she sometimes knows more about what's going on than I do, but you know what? Has God ever failed us? Have we ever not been able to pay our bills? God always works it out, right? So worrying about it don't add a nickel to the bank. Sometimes she'll say, hey, I just want to tell you, you know, things are tight right now. I go, okay. But see, I don't have to have money to be happy. Aren't you glad you don't have to have money to be happy? Because your happiness would fluctuate. The things of God are sustaining. Hear that word, sustaining. They sustain us. Hallelujah. For you that are filled with the Holy Ghost, you're going to get, this is good for you, because you need to know how, you need to be put in remembrance that there's a power in you that's supposed to be activated so you don't battle the things like everybody else does. They're handing out pink slips. The company where I work for may be going under. Well, then that guy, if God's going to close the door, he's going to open a new one. If he's going to close this door, he's going to open a new one, because you're his son and his daughter and he's going to provide for you. Amen? Oh, man. Well, yeah, after I worry about it for a while and get his attention, he knows the hairs on your head, people. He knows everything about you. Bible says he'll answer prayers before you even ask. You know, there's a place in God you can get to that I'm trying to get there, where Jesus said this, that wicked one comes and has nothing in me. Wouldn't it be great if you could just live a life where the devil just couldn't get to you? He'd knock on the door, but you always look in the little hole, go, nah, I ain't opening this door. Jesus, it's for you. And let Jesus open the door. Hello? Oh, he won't take him on. In the book of Job in the Old Testament, Satan told God, he said, you got Job so protected, I can't touch him. So if an Old Testament can be in a place where the enemy can't touch him, how much more could a New Testament saint be in a place where he can't be touched? Much the more. We Old Testament saints, the Spirit of God would come on them. New Testament saints, the Spirit lives in them. Isn't that better than something coming on you periodically or every so often? Or something that when you woke up this morning, it was there. You said, Jesus, it's all right. It's all right. Amen. He's in you. All right. So the Holy Spirit's been prophesied. He's coming. Well, he came. 2,000 years on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came. Boom. Jesus is the baptizer. You know what? If I pray for you this morning, and some of y'all, I had two women supposed to come today that I was going to pray with them after church. So I thought, you know, I'm going to redeem some time. I'm just going to teach on it. That way they can hear about it. Then I can lay hands on them after church and be done. They're not here, but I'm still going to teach on this. Oh, you must have missed the Lord. No, I think this is in season. Because there's some of y'all that are filled with the Holy Spirit and you're being idle with something great God's given you and you're not being a good steward over it. You know, if I give you a cool watch and I go to your house and it's laying on the floor somewhere, it's in your dog dish or whatever, and he's chewing on it, I might not give you another one. Because if you're not gonna be grateful for something, why would I give you another one? Why do we ask God for more if we've not been faithful with what He's already given us? If He's given us power and we don't use the power He's given us, why would He give us more? This gift keeps on giving. This weekend, my wife was with me, and she got to see her husband in action. It blesses her. It does. He says, I love to go places where you don't know people, because then words of knowledge can come, the gifts can operate, and it's cool. I love to see the power of God. Hallelujah. Well, Jesus is going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit today because you're going to ask Him to do it. We're not asking God. We're going to ask Jesus to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. Because it says in Matthew 3:11, John the Baptist says, I indeed baptize you unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I'm not even worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Two different baptisms, Holy Spirit and fire. There's a baptism of fire, there's a baptism of Holy Spirit. You know what this proves? I didn't see Jesus rise from the dead. I've never been to the Middle East or Israel. I've never seen the empty tomb. But I know He's risen because He baptized me in the Holy Spirit July 12, 1973. If He hadn't risen from the dead, how could He baptize me in the Holy Spirit? Because Jesus, He said, John the Baptist said, Jesus will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Well, I heard He got crucified and He died. But rumor has it He rose from the dead. I can testify that He rose from the dead because Jesus said that the day I'm with the Father, you'll know it because I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. If Jesus never came out of the tomb, He couldn't have got to the Father. And if He didn't get to the Father, He couldn't have sent the Holy Spirit. This proves He rose from the dead. Hallelujah. Of course, we know He did. We are commanded to receive this. This is not a request. This is not, hey, I don't know. I want the Holy Spirit. That tongue thing freaks me out. That's because you don't understand it. I'm going to do a little explaining today. But when you see the wisdom of God, you'll want... God does all things well. In Luke 24:49, it says, Behold, I send you the promise. What's the promise? It's the promise what Joel said would come. I send you the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem. Wait in Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. Endued means filled up. Are you filled up with power today? Four of you. Well, great. Well, people watch this on YouTube going, well, that church is... I don't know about that church. Endued with power from on high. This is power from on high. It comes from God. Boom. Through the Holy Spirit. It's more of God. How many of y'all want more of God? We sing songs about more of you, more of you. I want more of you. God says, okay, I'll give you more. But not that. What part of it do you... What part of God has ever been not good? You know, even the correction of God is good. Even when you're reproved and He gives you a good spanking, how many of it was for your benefit? How many of y'all glad you got some whoopings by the Lord? Because those whoopings turned you around, didn't they? You were about to walk slap off a cliff right into hell, and He went, whoa, son. Well, okay. Whoa, thank you, Jesus. I'm so thankful for those corrections. Everything he does is good. His timing is perfect. Somebody, I know some people, I don't know. Sometimes I think he's a little iffy on that. He waits a little too long. No, he's waiting to work something good in you. Without patience, you won't inherit the promise, the Bible says. Patience is a virtue. But to get patience, you have to go through trials. And see, people don't want to go through trials because trials suck. They're not always fun. That's why they're called trials. Jesus said, in this world, you will go through tribulations. He said, but be of good cheer. I mean, tribulations and cheer, those two, it's like, why did you say the word cheer? Be of good cheer. Because trials never seem to be a fun thing. But be of good cheer. I've overcome. The reason we can rejoice is because he said, I've overcome. Because I've overcome, I'll teach you how to overcome. And I'll tell you something, unless you overcome something, you'll never be able to help somebody else go through that thing. I know a lot of Christians that have knowledge. I talked about this over the week, but it was actually Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. A lot of people have knowledge, but they don't have wisdom. The Bible says wisdom gives life to knowledge. If you know 15 scriptures on salvation, but you've never led somebody to Jesus, you have knowledge, but you don't have wisdom. Because it takes wisdom to get people saved. It takes wisdom to get the gospel across to people where they see it and see the need for God in their life. It takes wisdom. The definition of wisdom is the ability to take knowledge and make it worthwhile, to see the value of it, to bring it to light. So some people have knowledge, and some people even have knowledge and wisdom. But I'll tell you, there's one step further. The Bible says wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom. With all you're getting, get understanding. You know, understanding's very, very, very valuable. You know, people tried to witness to some of y'all and never got through to you. And you, because you walked away going, they don't understand. And then somewhere along the way, somebody talked to you and touched your heart. It's like you were in a well, and people would lower a rope down to you, but their rope never seemed to be long enough. You know, if it's 6 inches too short, you still can't pull them out because they can't. And that's where some people's knowledge goes. It's not that, and even their wisdom sometimes lacks the understanding. Understanding is a long enough rope where they can tie it around them, and you can pull them out. Amen? But somebody with some understanding touched your heart, and you go, this guy gets me. This person understands. I believe he really... Love is a bridge, folks, where truth must travel. If there's no bridge, only information. So that love... See, when you understand the depths and the hurts of people because you love them, God will lengthen your rope, and you'll be able to reach a lot more people. Understanding is precious. So get knowledge, get wisdom, but with all you're getting, get understanding. Some people's knowledge of someone that drinks is, the Bible says no drunkard enter the kingdom of heaven. Really? That's as deep as you want to go? It does say that, but are you going to be able to reach that person? No. Because you have written them off saying no drunkard will enter the kingdom. Somebody with a little more wisdom comes along and says, well, Jesus still died for that man. He needs Jesus. But somebody comes along with understanding and says, I talked to the man. I found out what he went through in his life. The man went through tremendous abuse. I realized he drank because he was medicating the pain that he was in. And I was able to understand the pain he was in. Then I knew how to more effectively pray for him, deliver him, help him to get rid of the pain so he could accept the truth. See, understanding will go far deeper than just knowledge. Amen? We are commanded to receive this, not a request. Luke 49, it says, tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. Be filled up with power. The disciples, after Jesus ascended into heaven, they prayed for 10 days. Not 7, 10. 10 days. praying every day, nothing happened. Praying every day, nothing happened. You say nothing happened, they were praying. How many of you, when you pray, something happens? They were fellowshipping God. But they were told by Jesus, wait till you are endued with power. You will know when you're filled up. How many of you, when you eat food, you know when you're full? How do you know something? They say it takes 20 minutes from the time you start eating for the signal from your stomach to go to your brain and say, hey, we're full. So you're supposed to eat slow. But if you eat fast, I mean, you can put away some groceries in 20 minutes. Man, you can go to seconds and thirds. And then time to time, the signal hits your brain and says, hey, we're full. No, we're more than full. We overfull. Then you get up from the meal and you're going, gosh, man, I just want to sit on the couch for a little bit. We fueled our bodies to get energy so we could go out and do things. But we fueled it too much. Now we just want to sit down somewhere and go, oh, help me, Lord. Okay. Well, if you know when you're full physically, I'm going to tell you something, you'll know when you're full spiritually. Naturals and spirituals parallel. Always get it in the natural. Hallelujah. Well, so they're praying for 10 days and then boom, it happened. We're going to talk about it in a second. What does this Holy Spirit do? Well, I'm glad you asked. The Holy Spirit, why you want to receive Him. This is the number one reason why you would want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because, and St. John 14:15 says, if you love me, anybody love Him? Keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and He will give you another comforter. The King James says comforter. The new King James says helper. How many of y'all want a helper? Anybody ever need help with this walk with God? Ever feel like you're pulling on this rope and it's like, I could use some help here? Because Satan and devils and it seems like the world is pulling against you and it seems like there's thousands to one. But you know, when the Holy Spirit grabs the hold of you, he just goes, woo, come on. You know, we got this. He's God. He's powerful. I'll give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. If you have the Spirit of Truth, you can't be lied to. Oh, people will try, but the Spirit of Truth will go, eh. Even when you can't find the Scripture that would tell them contrary to what some... I know people that use their Bibles trying to deceive people. That's the best deception there is, when they use the Bible. But see, the bottom, when the Holy Spirit's going, I know what he's saying, and he's quoting a Scripture, but it doesn't fit there, it's not true. People will tell you, this is not for today. They'll show you a Scripture that says, where there's tongues, they shall cease. Well, I'll tell you something, tongues hadn't ceased. I was praying right before I came out here in them. Hallelujah. The Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive. Why? Because they don't see Him. I mean, He's a Spirit. The world's led by their five senses. If I don't see it, smell it, taste it, touch it, hear it, it ain't real. That's a limited way to live, isn't it? Because there are things that far past those five senses. You know, your spirit man has ears. Your spirit can hear things that your natural ears can't. You know, God can speak to you. It's a still, small voice nobody else can hear but you can. You know, there are smells. I was in a meeting the other day, and this person walked in the room and sat down. The whole atmosphere of the room shifted. This person carried in the presence of the Lord in such a capacity of joy, I felt it shift in the spirit. People carry things in their spirit. Hallelujah. Because they don't see Him nor know Him. But you know Him. For He dwells with you and He will be in you. I wish the Lord would show up. We'll get filled with the Holy Spirit. And you don't have to worry about Him showing up. He'll go with you everywhere you go. When you wake in the morning, Lord, He's going right here. The Holy Spirit will be with you everywhere you go. How many of those places you... When you get in places of darkness, you need more light, don't you? Hallelujah. I will not leave you orphans. The King James says, I will not leave you comfortless. Jesus knew He was going to heaven. He said, I got to give these boys something to go with them because I'm with them and they freak out. Well, who is this helper he's talking about? Well, it says in verse 26, 14:26 says, "But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name or by my authority, he will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I've said to you." Remember, the early Christians did not have Bibles. They could not reference the things that you and I can reference that Jesus taught. Jesus said, hey, the Holy Spirit's going to teach you and he's going to bring things to your remembrance. Isn't that cool? You ever read something on one night and the next day you go to work or something and somebody starts asking questions, you go, I just read that last night, and you can't remember it to save your soul? Get filled with the Holy Ghost and the Holy Ghost will bring it to your remembrance. When I get up here and preach, if you saw my notes, and my notes are not always what comes out. More comes out than what's on paper. I come up here sometime with three scriptures and we'll end up quoting 15 or 20 in my message, and you're going, where are those? Where's the... God bless the people in the media. They're like, man, it's hard tracking this guy. Unless he gives us notes, he's all over the place. He's quoted stuff this morning. It's not in his notes. I'm not limited to notes. The notes are really a map for me to get back to. Because sometimes, we go places. Hallelujah. But see, once it's on your hard drive, you can access it. A hard drive doesn't work. If you get a computer and there's nothing on it, you can't pull stuff up. There's nothing on it. But whatever you put on your hard drive, you can always recall it. You have access to it. So when you get filled with the Holy Spirit and you read your Bible, guess what? You're putting it on the hard drive. And the Holy Spirit can bring it to your remembrance. Okay. So he's going to teach you all things. That sounds kind of important to me. There's a lot of things I'd like to know. The Holy Spirit will teach me. Sometimes people say, I wish I lived in Jesus' day. I could have asked Jesus questions. Hey, you don't have to ask Jesus. Ask the Holy Spirit. Jesus even said, he said, I have many things I want to share with you. This is in the 16th chapter of St. John. I have many things I want to share with you, but you don't have ears to hear. He said, you don't have the understanding for it right now. But he says, howbeit, when the Holy Spirit comes, he'll bring it. He'll enlighten it. He'll bring you into these truths. There are things Jesus couldn't share with his disciples because it's over their head. He said, but hey, when the Holy Spirit gets here, he's going to remind you, he's going to bring you things. Jesus said, he won't speak of himself. Whatever he receives from me, he'll give it to you. Hallelujah. That's awesome. Well, this sounds pretty good, doesn't it? See, some of y'all that are field going, yeah, that's right, I have this. I can see it on your face. Yeah, this is in me. It is in you. Why are you acting like it's a new revelation? Well, it seemed like I kind of forgot about some of this stuff. Well, the fulfillment of promise. Remember what Joel prophesied? Prophecies come to pass. That's when they're fulfilled. You ever had a word spoken over you? Sometimes it had conditions to it and stuff. You ever seen it? Are you happy when it got fulfilled? Oh, yeah. All right, Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, it was the last day of Pentecost. Pentecost means 50. It's a 50-day celebration, Jewish celebration. It was the last day of Pentecost, the 50th day. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. The disciples were up there, been praying 10 days. This is the 10th day. They look outside, and the wind starts to blow through the room, but they look outside, and the palm trees are just standing there. They're going, ain't windy outside, but sure is windy in here. You know what the word pneuma is? The word spirit. It means wind. We sing about rushing mighty winds. We sing songs about, Lord, blow through this place. We need a good Holy Ghost blow it out time, y'all. We're getting too dignified around here, too reserved,
thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I want to tell you something. Sometimes you can go with dignity or you can go with deliverance. I'm going to go with deliverance. Who was that guy that had leprosy and then the prophet told him, Elijah says, go out there and dip seven times in the dirtiest river around. He didn't say, go over to Holy Hot Springs. Go to Marriott and get in the hot springs at the spa. Oh. He says, no, go to the Jordan. It's the dirtiest river around. The man's got open sores. He's got leprosy. getting in a dirty river. Hello, does that sound sanitary? People are going, you'll get infection. You already got leprosy. Are we adding sorrow to sorrow here? Elijah, prophecy, you're just the messenger. It don't have to make sense. It's prophecy. So he says, go dip seven times. He gets out there and he dips one time, comes up, still has leprosy. It's supposed to dip seven. And his servant's going, six more. And he's like, comes up. It's not happening. It's not working. You know, some people almost want to see God fail. Four. Five. It's not working. Still got leprosy. He gets the sixth dip, and he's about to walk out. And the servant says, hey, if he told you to do something great, you'd be all over that. But he just told you something to do real simple, so you really can't get any credit. I mean, God will set it up that way so you don't get the credit. He goes, come on, one more time. And I can see him almost mocking him. One more time. Okay, for you. And he goes under, and he comes. See, some people, well, he wouldn't get it because he didn't have a right attitude. No, he's being obedient. See, the fact that he dipped the seventh. Now, when he went under the seventh time and he came up, the Bible says his flesh was that of a newborn babe. He got new skin. Because he was obedient. As much teaching we do on the soul and how to get over your emotion stuff, we've let emotions creep in this church, and I don't feel like I used to. When I pray the Spirit, I don't feel like it's doing that much. Where did it ever say you feel anything? If you're having a bad day, pray in the Spirit. Your day can still go bad, but it don't matter. Your spirit's being built up. This isn't pixie dust, folks. It just makes everything happy and sparky. It gets your spirit, man, strong. Men, we need to be strong in this house. You know what? I don't have time. Yeah. I'm out chasing Pokemon. Isn't that going to be sad on the day of judgment? God's going to say, I wanted to move through you. I wanted to pour out my spirit upon you. I wanted you to raise the dead and do all kind of things, but you were too busy catching Zorkon. Oh, help us, Lord. You know, that Comic-Con, we were coming down the 5 yesterday, and it was the never-ending story. Took us almost 5 hours to get home from L.A. And it said, major event. Well, major event was Comic-Con. Comic-Con is not some little thing for tinny boppers. Grown men in their 40s and 50s go walking around getting autographs from guys from Star Trek. It's not real. Star Trek is a movie. No more than Jedi's. Oh, no way. You're touching sacred things now, brother. I'm not a Trekkie fan, but man, don't be messing with the Force. Okay. And people dress up and walk around, think they're Jedis for a day. And God bless them, it's funny. But so many people are so involved in what's not real as opposed to when we could be doing stuff that is real. Eternal. We went to L.A., spent 3 days at these people's house. In the 3 days, we imparted a lot of wisdom, a lot of truth. Took one man, 70-something years old, got him prayed through deliverance. He was set free, prayed for a 33-year-old woman. She got set free. That was powerful. Their lives are never going to be the same because of that. But got to prophesy over people. Good things happen. The devil manifested at one point. We got to show how to put the smack down on the devil. That's how, you know. We always want services to go smooth. We do. But when they don't, it's nice to know what that God knows how to take care of stuff, don't he? All right, so they're praying, and it says there's wind blowing through the house. It says, and then there appeared unto them divided tongues of fire that sat upon each of them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. At one point, Peter looks over and says, hey, John. Somebody's flicking a bick. They got a lighter behind you. And he goes, man, you got one too. They saw that. Everybody had little flames over their head. These are the guinea pigs, people. This is the first time it was poured out. I think they needed every manifestation they could get to know what was going on. We got wind, that means spirit. We got flames. John the Baptist said the Holy Ghost and fire, I guess, putting it all together. Now they're speaking in languages. They're Hebrew. They're Jews, so they speak Hebrew, but some of them were speaking Greek. Some were speaking Italian. Some were speaking Portuguese, different languages, and they didn't know what they were saying. I have heard people in Africa and different places around the world, when they get filled with the Holy Ghost, some of them speak in English. Blessed be your name. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, our God is awesome. Thank you, Jesus. Then go back into their language. They have no idea what they said. It was an unknown tongue. Though I speak with the tongue of men or of angels, it can be an angelic tongue. You don't know what it is. And there's wisdom why you don't. We're going to get to that. Hallelujah. I'm a little excited this morning. Peter verifies the gift because he walks out and everybody's out there going, man, what do you got? They thought they were drunk. Now that's a good thing, people. They walked out and said, these guys are like, woo-hoo! They were happy. They didn't walk out, boy, I just feel critical. I just want to judge people. That skirt is, you're showing too much flesh, lady. You know, and they show just their eyes. They didn't walk out with this religious spirit that made them judgmental and critical and stuff. They walked out with joy and smiling and laughing. And the people said, you guys are drunk. And Peter says, we're not drunk like you think. He didn't say, we ain't drunk. He said, we're not drunk as you suppose. Peter said, I ain't saying I ain't feeling pretty good. I ain't saying that it's kind of hard to stand right now. I'm going to just lean on this rail while I talk to y'all. Hallelujah. Peter verifies the gifts. He says, these men are not drunk as you suppose. Well, he is drunk, but not like you think. He says, since it's only the third hour of the day, it's 7 o'clock in the morning. We can't, the liquor stores ain't even open, y'all. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my maidservants, men servants and maidservants, will I pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. It's for all believers. If you a believer, this is a gift from God for you. The people said in Acts 2:37, it says, what must we do? We want this. You know, when you operate in the things of God properly, it makes people... The Bible says we are the salt of the earth. What does salt do? It preserves, but it also makes you thirsty. People should thirst for what you got. If people go, man, you're a religious nut. I don't want nothing to do with you. You're not manifesting the Spirit of God properly if you freak people out. I've been praying in tongues for 40-something years. Some of y'all have never heard me except ever so often when I do it in the pulpit. I'm going to do it today. Just buckle up. We're going to get ready to get freaked out. But see, the thing is, it's not like I walk around praying in tongues all the time. I don't walk into 7-Eleven going to get an icy. I'd like an icy shandalala moki sarabo ratai. How much is it? Okay. Thank you. I don't walk around tongues talking. I don't go to the post office. I'm checking my mail. Rika batando lamasate. How's it going? Robote. That's weird. I know people that are spiritual, that some of them are spooky. They want everybody to know what they have. How many, when you get a new ring, you want everybody to see it? You're walking out in the sun going, hey, how's it going? Oh, my head itches. Do you have a new ring? How many, when that girl that's engaged and she gets her ring, what is the first thing she's going to show? She's showing everybody. It went on Facebook. Forget it. Sunday's 4 days away. I got to get this to the masses. I'll get it on Facebook. Boom. I can blow it up on Facebook. You know, a quarter carat ain't that big sometimes, but you it's kind of like holding a fish. If you hold it out here, it's way bigger, you know. You get that quarter carat on Facebook and blow it up. Man, that's a big rock. You see them Sunday. What happened? But what do? You go tell everybody. When somebody asks you to marry them, you go tell everybody. Yoo-hoo! All right. So, what must we do to get this? Peter says, in verse 38, then Peter said to them, repent, let every one of you be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit. You got to be saved to get this gift. Amen? Because the Holy Spirit won't move in a dirty house, an unclean temple. But how long does it take to clean the temple? Just ask Jesus to forgive your sins, and the supernatural power of God will wash you clean. I'm talking zest squeaky clean. Amen? And you know what? This is his first altar call in the Bible. 3,000 people thought this was pretty cool. It says there were 3,000 souls added that day. All because some people were in an upper prayer room. You know that Mary was one of those, it was 120, it wasn't just the 12 apostles, y'all. It was 120 people in that upper room. That's 10 times 12. It says the mother of Jesus was in there. You want to witness the Catholics? Tell them, hey, you know, Mary got this gift. Mary got it? Yeah, she did. She spoke with tongues. Well, if Mary did it, I want it. I'm serious. They're all about Mary. The mother of God. If she did it, I think I want that. I've led Catholics to the Holy Spirit, prayed them to the Holy Ghost, just telling them that, hey, forget that God wants you to have this gift. Mary had it. Well, if Mary had it, if it's good enough for Mary, I want it. Use wisdom, people. Hallelujah. God wants people to have this gift because, you know, if you're a foot soldier, you have a rifle, you're powerful, amen? You're as powerful as the weapon you can carry. But would you feel a little more safe if as a foot soldier or you got to ride in a tank? Foot soldier steps on a mine, poof, foot soldier gone. Tank runs over mine, may blow a chain. It doesn't necessarily blow tanks up. The armor on a tank is tough. How many know if you really have to go for a long, you got to go 30 miles, foot soldier, getting a little weary. Especially with that backpack and all that stuff. 30 miles could be pretty, don't you want to be the guy in the tank? So which one has more power? The tank. If you're a born-again Christian, you're a foot soldier for Jesus. When you get baptized in the Holy Ghost, God takes you out of the foot soldier thing, opens the tank, puts you inside, shuts it, and says, give them heaven, boys. Do you realize when I take, as a foot soldier, and I shoot bullets at people behind a wall, they shoot bullets back, and we just shoot bullets back behind walls? Do you know when a tank aims its gun at a wall, everybody behind the wall runs? Because the wall's coming down. In fact, the whole building may come down. Y'all see this? That's a cool comparison. You're born again. You have power with God. You get baptized in the Holy Spirit. You bad to the bone. You're a force to be reckoned with. You have bigger guns, more weaponry. Satan's a little more afraid of you. You know, he looked on the day of Pentecost. He stuck his old bony head in the door and went, what's going on up there? Oh, my gosh. He saw 120 men become like Jesus. This Peter that denied Jesus just a few weeks before, he gets up and preaches and 3,000 people get saved. A few weeks later, he's praying for a crippled guy. The guy gets healed. He gets sent to jail. They beat him. They laid his back open with a whip. And he left going, man, they saw enough Jesus in us to beat us. Yeah. Well, isn't that guy a little different than the guy that said, I don't know him, blankety, blank, blank. He had to cuss to prove it. I would watch that video when I get to heaven. It's going to be the most apologetic cussing you've ever heard. you know when you're really washed in the blood, cussing just don't sound right with us, does it? It sounds weird for us, amen? So we ought not be doing it, amen? Amen? It comes out weird. Hallelujah. Well, it came out weird with Peter. They're like, what? Yeah, those are cuss words. I never heard them said like that. They almost sound nice. Hallelujah. But here, this man changed. He went from the time Jesus needed the most to being a man that gets his back laid open and he's praising God for being counted worthy to be beat. I would say that man had an encounter with power. All right. It's for all believers. After salvation only. You have to be born again. All right. Purpose of tongues. There's a purpose to it. Everything God does has a purpose. You know the hairs in your nose? they're a filter. The Nile, the science guy, what's his name? Bill Nile, the science guy. I know, I've learned things from Bill. Hallelujah. Do you know he recently got witnessed to by the guy that built the ark over in Kentucky? Yeah. He got witnessed to him, and the guy shared with about Jesus. It was a really good encounter. Hallelujah. You know that the atheist movement's trying to threaten all the schools not to let their kids go on field trips to the ark. They're so afraid that they're going to see something that's going to make a believer out of them. Man, we're in the last days. This is getting exciting. Man, they're trying to sue you and do everything they can to keep you away from the truth. But the truth is getting so prevalent. It's no longer hid under a bushel. Amen. We're like the Bible says, be a light that's set on a hill, a city set on a hill that cannot be hid. Hide Dallas. Good luck. Hide L.A. You can't hide it. It's the city. Hallelujah. But we're coming out. A lot of other people coming out, but we coming out. Amen? Amen. Well, they saw and heard them. How do you know when you're filled? Because I'll see and hear you speak in tongues. I saw and heard Jessica praying in tongues. I saw Sarah pray in tongues. I saw them. You're peeking? Absolutely, I'm peeking. Yep, that's... And I heard them. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. That's English. I understand that. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You say it really fast. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's still hallelujah. But when it shifts, you got to quit speaking in English and start speaking in a heavenly language. But I can't because the Holy Spirit hadn't come on you. I can't do that. And I couldn't either until the Holy Spirit came on me. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, He'll empower you to speak in a heavenly language. But why do I have to do that? Because not why do I have to, why would I? I'm going to tell you why. Because it's a gift and it'll help you in your walk with God. Number one, we see and hear, so we know you got it. Two, it builds up your faith. Anybody have a problem with faith sometimes lacking? Me and James. Thank you, James. You and I are the only two honest guys in the room. I have trouble with it. Do you know I pray in the Spirit a lot, especially when I go to minister. I don't know what you guys need. The Lord does. So I'm going to get my battery charged. So Jude 1:20 says, Beloved, that's Christians, building up yourselves upon your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. I got something going on here. It's pulling on my ear. There we go. But you, beloved, building up yourselves upon your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. When you pray in the Holy Spirit, you're building up your faith. Well, how does that work? I don't know. Just do it. I could go into more, but I'm going to redeem some time. How many of y'all want to edify yourself? You want to get built up? You want to get encouraged? No, I like discouragement. That's how I move into depression. I get discouraged. I get more discouraged, and then I get depressed, and then it just goes down from there. Well, you want to stop that? He that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. How many of y'all would like to have a direct line to God? When you pray in English, you pick up the phone and you say, Father, in Jesus' name. Jesus said when you pray this way. You pray through His name, don't you? Isn't Jesus the mediator between man and God? The Bible says Jesus Christ. So Jesus is kind of like the operator connecting you with the Father. Isn't that true? When you end your prayers, don't you end your prayers, in Jesus' name I pray? You're saying through Christ or through His authority, Father, please answer this prayer request. And God goes, okay. So you got that phone. That's a good one. But then you got this other phone that's the devil line. Oh, it may not look like a devil phone. It may even have angels on the side of it and all kinds. It may glow white when it calls. But you know, when the devil calls you, how many know you can tell it's him because he starts right off the bat condemning you? You don't read your Bible enough. You don't pray enough. It doesn't say, hey, this is Lucifer. I thought I'd call you up and chat. It comes up and says, hey, this is the Holy Spirit. Hey, this is God talking. Man, what's wrong with you? You're out there. You ever notice that every time you've done something wrong, that phone rings right away? You know, if I get in a tiff with Bryn and I leave down the driveway, that phone's a ringing. It goes with me. It starts ringing. Oh, yeah, that's really spiritual. Aren't you just the man of God? Now, the Holy Spirit's already convicted me of whatever we've talked about because He does that immediately. But by the time I'm down the driveway and down the road, another call comes in. I think it's the Lord trying to verify what he told me leaving down the driveway. But no, it's not the Lord. It's Splitfoot. He's saying, oh, yeah, I'm not through with you. I just started on you. You went to L.A., you preached this, and you're doing this, and you're doing that. Oh, man, yeah, yeah, yeah. And you just go, yeah, I know. I'm hang that one up. People call me sometimes, Brother Mike, I need prayer. The devil's been talking to me all morning. My first question is, why all morning? If it's the devil, why are you even listening to him? Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Are you losing your joy? Yeah, it's the devil. Hang up. You feeling less? You feel like you're dying inside? Yeah, that's the devil. Hang up. That's killing you. All right. But there's another phone. And this one, it's like the bat phone. It goes straight to Commissioner Gordon. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men but unto God. When you're praying in the Spirit, your Spirit's talking directly to God. I don't know about you, that's the express line. We just came back from Disneyland a few weeks ago. We had these cool tickets, what do they call them? Fast Pass. Man, whoever thought of that was a smart guy. Excuse me, going to the front of the line. We were in the carpool lane going down the highway yesterday, and all this traffic was moving real slow, and there's a place where we got to go fast. I'm doing this on the side of my, looking at those people going, hey, how's it going? Yeah, I was having fun. Bryn's like, honey, quit. It's like, that's just so awesome. They're like sitting there, and here we're, there's two of us. Sorry about it, just one of y'all. Just having fun. Somebody going, I'm glad I don't go out in public with you. It's an adventure. This is a fast pass phone. It gets you a direct line to God. All right. Speaks not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him. When you pray in the Spirit, you don't know what you're saying, because you're part of that no man. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. You share secrets with God. So, am I the only guy in this room that realizes that I'm this little peanut of a brain is talking to an all-knowing, all-infinite wisdom God? I'm a little intimidated, y'all. I don't feel that smart. And God's like, yeah, I know, Mike. I'm going to give you a language you can talk to me. You'll feel more confident when you pray in the Spirit because you can know at least it's intelligent. And it's His will. You ever pray for God about stuff that's not God's will? You're talking to God like you're trying to, the more you pray, you're trying to talk Him into it. Now, Lord, I need this new car. You know, I mean, I'm thankful for the car I have, but this new car, I think it would really help my image. You know, you want us to have a good image in the public. I mean, God, you can go on and on. God's like, you know, well, it's going to put you in major debt. This is not the season and time. And, you know, I don't have a problem blessing you, but this is not the time. Well, yeah, but God, but I really, have you seen the mileage on my car? I mean, you just go on and on. If God says it's not time, it's not time. But we're going to talk more about it. We're going to wear them down because it always worked with Mama. It always worked with Dad. If I could just wear them down, I kept asking. I do the little bat the eye thing. Dad, Sheree, Dad, I need that. Yeah, I know you didn't have to do it. He was more than willing. Dad, what do you want? We want Sheree. So we think that if we just through much words, and then sometimes that's not worse. We start bawling and squalling and trying to pull on His heart. You can't manipulate God. You know, witchcraft don't work on God. In case you tried it, yeah, I never really felt like it works. It doesn't. You can't strong arm him with, you know, arm him with crying and getting all emotional and stuff. No, it don't work. So how are we going to talk to an all-knowing, all-wise God and pray effective prayers? It says right here. Yahweh keep asking all the right questions. But he who prophesies speaks edification, exhortation, and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. My next verse talks about that intercession. But here's, when you pray in an unknown tongue, you edify yourself. You build up your own battery. It's a battery charger to keep your battery charged. Does anybody ever feel drained? You ever feel built up and pumped up, edified, just spent time in prayer closet, had a really good worship time, and you come out and somebody, ding dong, look out there, oh no. I mean, Satan knows who to send to you sometimes. It's like, oh no. Somebody, you want to have a Bible study? Yeah. And no, they're not Bible studies with you. They're arguments. I'm telling you, I believe it's for today. You can tell me all you want. It's not for today. I'm not gonna deny the faith in this area. I mean, Satan wants to send weird things. Or just you get built up and then you go to the post office and you get your bills and they're a lot more than you budgeted for. How many of that can mess with you? Or you go to the supermarket and you're in your new car and then somebody backed into it. I mean, there's a number of things that can ruin your day. Something as simple as kaflush. Whoa. Hello. Little things can just upset you. This is an ability to keep your battery charged. See, right now you're being edified. When you come to church, I try to charge your battery, I try to inspire you, I try to encourage you, I try to build you up in the faith. If I do it right, when you leave, if you felt bad coming to church, when you leave, you should feel better. Some of you go, well, sometimes I feel pretty good coming to church, and sometimes I leave feeling bad. Well, that's called conviction. And that's not my fault. I'm not the one doing that to you. If you're feeling bad or feeling convicted about something, that's the Holy Spirit doing His job, and you need to talk to Him about it. I'm just the messenger. All right? There's a difference between conviction and condemnation. Condemnation beats you up and makes you feel like you can't repent because you're just a mess. But conviction says you need to deal with this. This is something you need to deal with. And you just deal with it. All right. Here's a great scripture. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, helps our, the King James says infirmities, this says weakness, but that word infirmity in the Greek means physical, mental, or moral weakness. Anybody ever have moral weakness? You get tempted, you know, hello. Anybody ever have mental weakness? That was a weak amen, but there's some of y'all like me that have some, yeah. Physical, you ever feel sick? Do you know when you pray in the Spirit, it actually Help your body feel better? It does. Okay. So the Spirit helps our infirmities, our weakness. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. That's the Word of God. I don't always know how to pray for things as I ought. But the Spirit Himself makes intercessions for us. The word intercession means to go before a high authority on the behalf of somebody else. An attorney is an intercessor, Your Honor. My client, and they plead your case. The Holy Spirit, man, I wish I knew more of the Bible. Guess what? The Holy Spirit knows the Bible. He knows how to plead your case. Praise God. But the Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered, our words we don't understand. Now He searches the hearts and knows what is the mind of the Spirit because He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. He's praying for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for the good of those that love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. People always quote Romans 8:28 out of context. Something bad happens, we know all things work together for the good. Oh, my son just got ran over, but you know, some good's going to come out of that. How many of that scripture don't fit? You can't comfort people in tragedy with that verse. It doesn't fit there. It fits when you say, I don't know how to pray for things, but I'm going to pray in the Spirit. And when I pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit's going to make a perfect prayer to God. And when once this prayer is made to God, then I can say, I know all things are going to work together for the good because I just prayed not my will, the Holy Spirit's will, God's will. So it's all going to work out. That's where that scripture ties in. It only fits right there. You have to do verse 26 and 27 for verse 28 to work. So when people quote it out of context, people just remind them. All right. And the Bible says in 1 John 5:14, it says, this is the confidence we have in Him. If we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. So when you're praying and it's the will of God, He hears that. What happens when you're praying and begging and pleading with God about something that's not His will? The longer you pray, it's not going to make it any more so. I've seen people down here bawling and squalling, going through boxes of Kleenexes, trying to get God to do something on their behalf that's not His will. And it's like, man, you're making a mess and you're using up a lot of tissue, but it's not all the tissue's not going to affect Him. It's not His will. Not His will. All right, so there's a purpose in tongues. Charge your battery, build your faith, pray prayers of intercession. Right there, those three right there would be worth it. Amen? So it's a gift. But we're not praying for tongues. We're praying to get filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will empower you. When you read the Bible, it'll come alive. It'll make more sense. He'll give you wisdom about... The Holy Spirit just doesn't do spiritual things. He'll help you with natural things. He'll tell you not to invest in things. I mean, if the Holy Spirit's God, and He is, He's part of the Trinity, God the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, does He not know the future? Does God know the future? So if you're going to invest in something that's not good, do you think He knows? Do you think if you prayed and asked the Lord, you know, about, should I invest in this thing? The Holy Spirit says, eh. But, you know, I've got some good tips here. Eh. But I think I should. Eh. But, so you say, no. But I'm just going to invest a little bit. Because this is a really good tip. And you invest a little and you lose it all. Well, it's a good thing I didn't invest a lot. You shouldn't have invested any. Because He told you not to do it. Then you should pray about things like houses. You know, you could go in a house, it could look like a really good deal. You get in there, and 2 months after you're there, the plumbing all goes wacko. You know, all of a sudden, bugs just start coming everywhere. Find out they're termites. We got such a killer deal. Operative word, killer. Your house is dying. It's being eaten alive. But we got a real screaming deal. Yeah, you're going to be screaming. The blessing of the Lord make rich and add no sorrow. Let's follow Him. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. He'll direct your paths. God knows what's going on. Well, I'm just saving. Brother Mike, I don't have the relationship with God. You're a pastor. You get a lot of free passes. I'm just a brother in Christ. I only got 3 wishes with the monkey's paw. I only got a couple more wishes with my clover leaf. Really? I thought you had as many as you needed. I thought in all your ways you could acknowledge Him. Well, I'm just saving those the 911 call prayers for when something really bad happens. You know, the Bible says He's perfecting those things that concern you. You don't have to wait till your kid's on and life flight being flown to the hospital. You can talk to God about every little thing. If it touches you, it touches Him. He's concerned about an ingrown hair or an ingrown toenail as much as He is about cancer. To Him, it's all the same. If it's bringing you discomfort, well, no one dies from an ingrown hair. No, but it still could be uncomfortable. And God doesn't want you to suffer. Not if He can help it. Amen? He don't want you living in a house that becomes a beast of burden. Hallelujah. Amen? So this praying in tongues kind of sounds like something I should be doing. How many of y'all filled with the Holy Ghost in this house? Amen. Do you pray in the Spirit? Well, when I got filled, how long was it? 3 years ago. Are you still praying periodically? How's your prayer language? Well, I'm up to 4 syllables. How many did you get when you got prayed for? 2? I can tell you right there, by reason of use, you ain't praying much. The more you pray in the Spirit, the more your prayer language grows. And you want a good prayer language, people. You want to be able just to go at, get after it. Hallelujah. Well, how many of y'all still tracking you? This sounds like something I'd like to pray about it. I'd like to seek the Lord about it, whether He wants me to have this particular gift or not. You know, do all speak with tongues? It's not everybody, Brother Mike, gets this. I've heard that so many times, it's not even funny. There's 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. They're gifts. This is the prayer language you get when you get filled. Everybody that gets filled with the Holy Ghost speaks in tongues. This is not the prayer language that you give messages in tongues in church. This is the prayer language that you use to edify, build yourself up, pray in the Spirit, keep your battery pumped, and to keep you strong in the Lord. Well, not everybody gets that. Yes, everybody does. In the book of Acts chapter 2, when they got filled, they all spoke with tongues. Acts chapter 10, when they got filled at the house of Cornelius, they spoke with tongues. Acts chapter 19, they got filled with the Holy Spirit, they spoke in tongues. In the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses, let everything be established. Why would God fill me with the Holy Ghost? Give me a prayer language, Matt. Fill you with the Holy Ghost, and you just got chicken skin.
Yeah, my hand got all those little bumpy things, like that's like another air conditioning vent.
You were.
Well, that probably explains it. Well, I really felt...
Well, that's glad you felt something. But see, it wouldn't be fair. I get this prayer language where I can do all kind of cool things, and he's waiting for his prayer language. Get it. If I pray for you, we ain't done to you. I hear you praying. Amen? Yeah. Hallelujah. Well, thank you, Jesus. Well, anybody want this gift? It's a gift. How do you receive it? You ask. That's it. Not more complicated than that. You ask. How'd you get saved?
I crawled on glass to the altar.
No, well, not in this church. You don't have to do any penance. You prayed the sinner's prayer. You repented of your sins. You asked Jesus in your heart, and you were born again. You came in through the... We all came through the same door. Amen? Jesus, I'm sorry. I'm messing up. Forgive me. Okay, I forgive you. All right. Go on. Serve me. Amen. I got saved June 15, 1973. A month later, I got filled with the Holy Spirit. So I went to a church where this guy was preaching on it. I don't know about you. I'm this way. If it's in the Bible, God wants me to have it, I'm all over it. I want it. Because when I started finding out the Holy Spirit gave out more gifts, I like gifts. That's my wife. She'll tell you, oh, yeah, he loves gifts. One of my languages of love. I like gifts. I'm wearing a watch. It was a gift. I'm wearing a shirt. It was a gift. I like gifts. And I found out God likes to give them. I love God. It benefits to be a Christian. My wife got blessed with a new Bible. Not just it's the Cadillac of Bibles, one she's always wanted. And a brother gave it to her up and bought her brand new. It came 2 days later. I knew about this, and I was quiet for 2 days. Long as 2 days of my life. I was in travail up in L.A. Oh, man. The good thing I got the minister and keep occupied, because I knew what was coming. And she was undone when she got it. See, and the man that gave it to her was just blessed by being able to do something kind. You know, giving people gifts, isn't it a blessing? It's more blessed to give than to receive. I was happy that she received it, but I looked at the guy's face. He looked just as happy as she did. And I'm thinking, man, you're out a lot of money, and I don't see how this is working. No, he's being blessed and she's being blessed. And God's being blessed. How do you receive this gift? You ask, and God will give it to you. Because he wants you, beloved. He don't want these bullets that sometimes ricochet and wound us. He wants... See, the thing about tanks, they cost like $50 million. They're not cheap. And most people can't, and armies can't, don't have enough to put all their foot soldiers in them. But you know, if you were an army on the earth and every one of your soldiers had a tank, do you realize nobody would mess with you? You would be so powerful, everybody would be scared to death of you. But see, God is not limited by finances. He wants to put every one of his sons and daughters, soldiers, in a tank and to keep them protected. See, when the enemy shoots at you and you're in a tank, you hear this, tink, 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 tink. He's trying, ain't he? Ting. And everyone wants to hear a tonk, tonk. Oh, 50 caliber. It still ain't getting through. Now, if you out there walking, it's a mess. That's a great analogy. Some of y'all going, yeah, I'm luckier than most. When bullets are flying, I don't feel lucky. I have Kevlar. See, I just, people sometimes resist. They want to do it in their own strength. Why? When you can sit in the tank of God and just look at this little thing and go, oh, when do I get to pull the trigger? Don't you want to pull the trigger? Every guy in this room wants to blow stuff up because it's in us. We're little boys that like to blow things up. And I just, you know, I got to blow things up this week. Blew the devil off people's lives. Blew people that were lacking knowledge and understanding and wisdom. Where they were held captive, poof, we blew those strongholds up and imparted revelation, knowledge, and wisdom. When we left, people were saying, man, my life's changed for these 3 days. See, that's power. That's the tank. I want every saint in this house tank worthy. Desiree, tanking it, girl. I'm right with you, Brother Mike. You know? We want to be in tanks.
I just feel so vulnerable. I feel like the devil's always whooping up on me. Get in a tank.
How are you going to yell and get mad at God when God's going, hey, you can get me. I'm all shot up. You go, yeah, because you're not in the tank. Get in the tank. He preached on it last week. Why? What's taking you so long? Get in the tank.
Get in the tank. What's the word of the Lord today? Get in the tank. Get in the tank. So we're going to dismiss. If you need to meditate on it, go ahead on. I don't have a problem with that. But at some point, get in the tank. Some of y'all are going to come to me probably weeks from now. I heard it. I just didn't know about it. The tongue thing was freaking me out and stuff. I don't know. But you know, when you come in there all bloody and stuff, you know, I just can't take this anymore. I've been hiding behind every brick and wall. I feel like everywhere I go, I'm getting shot. It's at some point, you're going to say, that tank's sounding better and better. Because that comfort. And I'll tell you something. When you watch the news, if you're not in the tank, you're going to get vexed. You watch the news, you watch what's going on, it'll vex you because you see what the enemy's doing. And the enemy's magnifying his power. But I want to tell you something. Oh, magnify the Lord. You don't magnify the devil, you magnify the Lord. If watching the evening news vexes you, don't watch it.
Yeah, but I have to. I'm an American. I need to.
My dad thinks you have to watch the news. He tells me, son, did you see the news today? I don't have the news, Dad. I don't watch the news. Well, then you don't know about what's going on, no. Oh, you really should watch the news, son, because you know what. You know, I'm not always part of the solution, people. I don't think that I am so powerful in God that my prayers shape the course of the world. I'm just trying to get some of y'all in the tank. See, I came back to that thing. I'm just trying to get y'all moving with God. My measure of rule is not Afghanistan. It's not Ethiopia. It's not Chile. It's not Paraguay. It's Ramona. I'm just trying to get you, when you stand before the Lord one day, I want to be able to, on the sidelines, go, I don't want a knot in my throat. I don't want somebody going, I don't want going, oh boy, come on, Jesus. I want to be able to say, as Matt, you stand in front of the Lord, I want to be able to say, you know, he's going to get a crown. I know this man. I've watched him serve God. I watched him run this race. Jesus is going to say, well done. Then when Jesus is going to turn and say, Matt Jones, well done. How good. And he puts that crown on his head. I'm not going to be, whoa, I didn't see that coming. Whoa, man. Whoa, thank you, Lord. I'm going to be rejoicing. Amen. See, I want to see you get there, Phil. I want to see when Jesus puts that crown on your head and go, Phil, some of them didn't know you, but I knew you. They didn't see the passion in your heart, but I saw it. Amen. I don't want to be surprised. I want to know those who labor among me. Amen. Maureen, I know he's going to put crown you, girl. So we're all running this race. When I get up here on Sunday, I know I can be funny at times, but listen, really pay attention, because I love you, and humor's fun, and it makes it a little easier to take sometimes, but I'm not just beating my gums up here. I'm speaking from experience. The Holy Spirit is powerful. It makes a difference in life. I don't want you getting shot up when you can be in a tank. Our God is a rich God, all-powerful God. You know, when you're in a tank, guess what? Something else. You're being powered by something else. You can walk, but isn't it better to ride? I mean, we could have walked to L.A. if we wanted to, but I'm so glad we rode. There was times yesterday I felt like people walking were passing us. That's why it took 5 hours to get home. Oh, look at the kid on the skateboard. Man, he's moving. We're not. But we did get home. But some of y'all are getting weary and well-doing because you're doing it in your own strength. God didn't call you to do it in your own strength. He called you to do it in His strength. Not by might, nor by power, but by His Spirit, says the Lord. It's His Spirit. Okay? We're not trying to embarrass anybody. Come up, make a spectacle of it. We're not Pentecostal. Come up here so we can all lay hands on you and freak you out. I grew up with that stuff. It freaks people out. No, I'm saying come by the office. We'll sit down and pray. And we'll get this. And God will fill you right there. Amen. I'm on your side. I want you to get filled. Carla, it does make a difference, don't it? Sometimes it takes a while to believe that's God, but it does make a difference. Hallelujah. But now we know it's God. Amen. Hallelujah. The mind is unfruitful. Paul says, I'll pray in the Spirit and I will pray with understanding. I pray in English. I, you know,
Hey, that's understanding. But sometimes you need to deny your soul the right to always think it's smarter than your spirit. Your spirit is way smarter than your soul. The real you is not you in soul, it's the you in spirit. When you got born again, that's the person we're interested in. That's the person that makes us happy. That's the person we really love. That old guy that was born back in the original birth, not such a nice person. When he's not walking with Jesus, not fun to be around. But when you got born again, that person, oh my goodness, we love that person. So let's work on that person to be the best they can be. The Holy Spirit works, doesn't it, Miss Mike and Rebel? The word association is coming, bro. It does. I never believed it, but you're a believer now. It does make a difference, Jessica. Amen. It doesn't make everything fly around like Superman, but it does give you power to overcome. All right, that's all I got to say about that. Not try, I don't want to feel like I'm ever trying to talk you into it. Get in the tank. I don't want to feel like that. You're feeling like that. You know, you're being pressured to get in the tank. No, I don't want that. You ever feel that way? I just want you to, I don't want you to feel left out when we're all riding around in our tanks and you're walking. I don't never want you to feel that way. I want you to feel just as loved and accepted by God as us riding in our tanks. And we're saying, come, get in your tank. Doesn't love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things? Don't we want everybody in this room to live victorious in Christ? We don't want to see anybody struggle if they don't have to. And that's all I'm saying today. I'm your big brother in Christ. I love you, and I want you to get in that tank because you know what? It's air-conditioned. When you're in the desert, an air-conditioned tank's pretty nice. There's canteens in that tank. Amen? There's safety. And there's other brethren in that tank. It takes more than one person to drive a tank. It makes you realize we need the body of Christ more connected. So this week, if you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, call me. I'll be in the office. Come on by. We'll talk. It's as simple as asking, getting your hands laid on you, and receiving this gift. Amen? All right. See you this week. You that are in the tank, keep on driving. You that aren't, come see me.